Veronica and Zach, here you guys. Hi everybody, thanks for coming to our panel. I'm Veronica Taylor.
I'm Zach Callison.
Happy New Year. So we're here to answer your questions, really.
Yeah.
I guess, is there a very specific way? Ah, okay, cool. So I guess, why don't we just start?
Yeah.
Any questions?
Yeah, hopefully our other friends will be joining us very soon.
Hi.
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 Good morning. Thank you for coming.
It's very exciting.
Oh,
we can hear you.
Okay. So my question is, do you know anything about the incident that happened at the Big Donut?
That's a really good question. I'm afraid to ask. I feel like I should, because it seems like a whole plot of an episode in the future that I really want to see, but I know nothing of it at the moment. I mean, we're pretty far ahead in production for episodes, but I really should bug Rebecca about that, because it seems like it'd make a really good story.
And, are there any songs, like more recent ones, because I was watching panels and you had some favorite songs, but there are more songs now. Is there a song that you really, really love from Steven Universe, like your favorite song from Steven Universe?
I mean, I love all our music, because we're really fortunate to have a really amazing songwriting team behind them, but some of my favorites to sing were Stronger Than You, Cookie Cat, of course. But overall, probably, even though I had nothing to do with the song itself, Stronger Than You really blew me away. So, I mean, it's Estelle.
That was the
song. You can't go wrong with her. It's just a pop star sensation. It was so well produced. So that's probably my favorite overall.
Okay, thank you.
Of course.
Thanks.
Over there.
My name's AC.
First of all,
First of all, I want to say thank you to both of you for your work. Veronica, your Pokemon was a huge part of my childhood and continues to be a huge part of my life to this day. And Zach, Steven Universe is possibly one of my favorite shows on television, like ever. And my girlfriend and I were Ruby and Sapphire yesterday.
Wow.
I was Ruby, she was Sapphire, and it was great.
That's awesome.
And I have two small questions for you. One is, who is your favorite character on the show besides Steven?
As far as gems go,
just in general, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, in general, I like some of the side characters from the town. Onion and Ronaldo are two that stick out. And as far as gems go, you can't go wrong with Peridot. Angry Space Dorito is my favorite. I'd probably say those three.
Right.
I can't really narrow it down to one particular
one. And the other one is, do you have a favorite episode?
Yeah, I have a few favorite episodes, but my favorite one to do was Steven and the Stevens, because, I mean, it's kind of narcissistic, but every single Steven on screen had to be voiced by me, so it was, I mean, it was exhausting, and we somehow managed to fit into 1 4-hour session, but that was a very fun one to do, plus all the music, and it was awesome.
But, like, what are your favorites to watch?
Jailbreak, probably.
Okay.
I'm strong with the
music. Both good. And, I'm sorry that I don't have any questions for you. I just want to say my friend Jake is a huge fan of yours. And I just
want to say hi
to you for her. So.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
And I'll tell her that I said hi.
Okay. Please tell her I said hi.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
Thank you, too.
And the Ash is kind of a childhood hero, so.
Awesome.
You and me both.
Do you really watch the show that often? Do you have time to do that?
Your show?
No, your show.
Your
own show.
Oh. Hi.
Every now and then, yeah.
Hi there.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good. I like your roles in some of your shows. I like you and as Captain Marvel.
Oh, thank you.
And yours from Welcome to Space Show as Marie the Dog Lady.
Oh, thank you.
And Botan. If you were movie makers for a film that's a crossover of Captain Marvel and Pokemon and Yu Yu Hakusho, how would you make that?
How would we make a show that was a crossover between all of those?
I'd say, I mean, Captain Marvel, he harnesses the power of lightning, so he would definitely get some awesome duo screen time with Pikachu. No doubt.
Yeah, that's true. Oh, do we get to play our, I thought we were just going to get the energy from those shows, like we'd have characters that ride lightning balls, and we'd have really kooky voices that we'd never done before, and we'd play all the characters.
Yes,
that's probably
please.
More like what we would do. Oh, but if you want Captain Marvel,
I mean, we'll write some new stuff in there.
Yes,
yeah,
so
I love doing new voices.
Other characters.
Yeah,
that'd be cool.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Sure.
Hello. I've been waiting since 1998 for this moment. It's so awesome meeting you.
Well, it's nice to meet you too. You're a lot taller now.
Okay. Actually, I was 19 then.
Okay.
Yeah.
Still, I bet you are.
But I just want to say it's an honor to meet you. And before I get to anything else, would you have time to get a picture after the panel?
Sure. And we're also down in our booths.
We're gonna have our booth set up.
Doing pictures.
Okay.
Yeah, pictures and autographs down there too.
Okay, yeah, and I've got a few things to give you. I've got some cookies.
Oh, is that a Pikachu cookie?
Yes.
Wow.
Awesome.
I hope it's not too powerful. These are just my own views on the Pokemon series health bar.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So
nice, thank you. Oh, we have one
camera.
Oh, hold on.
Oh, my God.
A product placement.
I wanted to ask what was it like when episode 18 got dubbed? What was it like recording for it, and how come it was only aired on two occasions?
What was episode 18?
Beauty and the Beach. Yeah.
What was it?
Beauty and the Beach. Yeah, it was the one that got banned because of that scene with Jesse and James. But
was it banned? Did we record that?
It aired in 2000. It was banned because there was a scene where James had inflatable breasts. But
right.
The episode was aired, but it got cut.
So
that scene got cut, but it was only aired twice, even though there wasn't anything else offensive.
You know, when we dub something, this is going to disappoint you because it wasn't a controversial thing recording it, because I have no idea. If Ash wasn't in the scene with them, I never even saw it.
Okay.
I don't, when we dub things, we just do all of where our lines show up in the show and don't see the whole show. Most of the time, because early on, we worked very quickly trying to get the shows going because they were kind of going right to air.
Okay.
So it was similar to many of the other episodes we did, where we just kind of did our work and went through. I don't know that I've even seen that one.
Okay. Could you comment on those cookies in Ashley's voice?
I'd like to,
Ashley, what do you think of those?
These are pretty awesome, but I would never eat Pikachu's head. Maybe his ears. These are so cute. Awesome. Hey, Bulbasaur, I chew you! I couldn't take any money. Thank you so much. Oh my gosh, thank you. But of course, in my Pokemon world, who needs money? Thank you. Thank you very much. These are amazing. Thank you.
Hi, I've got two questions for Zach. So first of all, I know that when you started voicing Steven Universe, you were kind of young, so I was wondering, how did you like get that role if you were relatively young?
I think I was 13 when I initially auditioned for the pilot. Basically, I just had my agent, they sent me the short presentation that Rebecca had put together to pitch to Cartoon Network. It was just some drawings of Steven, 10 lines of dialogue from the original pilot, a backing track with her vocals and ukulele on it for the extended theme, and just a character bio. And I went into my voiceover teacher, and we kind of created the voice in a few minutes and then spent the next hour trying to get these lines down. And I had a really good feeling about it when I did it, and something just felt like it clicked.
Okay.
Yeah.
Second question, sorry. It's when you first saw the first episode of Steven Universe, what were your initial thoughts of it?
It was very surreal. It's something about watching Steven Universe for me is that the voice of Steven is so much different than my actual voice that I can kind of watch the show without cringing and hearing myself and enjoy it, just like you guys do as a fan, which is really nice. I enjoy that aspect of it, but seeing the show grow and evolve and watching it on TV has been very surreal because I never thought that we'd get this much support from people like you. And I have a lot of appreciation for it, but it's been very overwhelming and very awesome.
Yeah. Thank you.
And it is a great thing to be able to play a character that's so different from yourself.
Right.
Because then you really can go into work and be the character and not really pull your own baggage in with you in a way.
Exactly. You know? And Steven's such a happy, giving person that
so
it's...
So different from you. I mean, the times we've had to pull you out of depression.
We don't talk about that.
Not today. Happy New Year!
Yay!
Thank you.
So getting into that mindset of Happy Steven definitely lifts up my days every Wednesday when we're recording.
So it's Wednesday.
Wednesday?
Wednesday.
This time? Okay, I'll be there.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good question.
Hello.
Hi.
Your cosplay is so cool.
Thank you. So for my question, Zach, I heard that there was a show that you were not allowed to watch when you were little that all your friends went to, and that was Scooby-Doo 2, Monsters Unleashed.
No way.
So I went out.
No way. I love you so much. There is a story behind this, and I was actually with my friend, whose birthday this was, like, 2 days ago. I celebrated New Year's Eve with him and then left town, but it was his sixth birthday, right? And we went to the mall. This is in St. Louis, Missouri, where I'm from, just was. And this, we were all going to see this movie for his birthday, but first we ate. And we had, like, hot dogs or something, and for some reason I remember him throwing up. And then we're like, okay, he's better, let's go see the movie. And we're all walking into the theater, and my dad just is like, hey, wait, you can't see this. This is age inappropriate. Now, the worst part about this is that this movie's rated PG, and I had seen the first one. Dad. I got my revenge. Thank you so much.
And then for my question for the both of you guys, what is the most awkward thing that happened to you while recording?
While recording, well, probably awkward for other people, if not me, but I was working on a show, and it was His and Her Circumstances, and she has this, you know, has this huge screen that normally I think most people would breathe and not just try to do it all in one breath, but I really went for it, and afterwards I just fainted. And so, because, you know, we all need air. So anyway, I gave a lot for that performance. But you can imagine me, when you're in the booth, there's just a window, and I'm standing in front of the window, screaming, and then I just disappear. And then they're like, is everything okay? I'm just kind of, yeah, fine, I'm fine. I'm really sad. So awkward more for everyone else than me.
I mean, my voice cracks sometimes, nothing like
that. don't worry, we don't have to compete for this.
I was like, really concerned for a long time, because like, my voice was kind of changing, and I felt really self-conscious about it. And I mean, Steven's voice is pretty up there, trying to do it, and it still cracks to this day, and I still get flustered about it. And they're like, no, just do it again. So I'd stop in the middle of the line I cracked on, and just start in the beginning, and go onward, but... I think you took the cake on that one.
Sad, isn't it?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Life goals now is to faint in a voiceover booth.
Right, but now actually, you may watch this and then thank your dad for not letting you see it. We'll see.
I haven't read the reviews for the movie, so only one way to find out.
Have you seen Scooby-Doo 2? Is it on your top 10 favorite list?
It was okay. All right.
Not to ruin it for you.
I have a feeling no matter what happens, I'm going to be really...
You have to watch the original cartoon. That's where it's at.
I love the original cartoon. Actually, I did a small part on the newer series.
It's, really?
Yeah. I met Fred
which
Walker.
Which episode was that, Zach?
It was episode 5. No, I don't know. It was very brief, but I got to work with Frank Welker, who did the voice of...
Oh, that's so awesome!
He's been doing the voice of Fred for like 50 years.
Wow.
And he now does the voice of Scooby, since the original actor passed away. And he switches between the scenes. It's
That's
very,
so neat.
Very cool, very intimidating to be in the room with him. But yeah. He's a great guy.
Wow. And your question,
Hi.
Sir?
So I'm Joe. This is for Veronica. I just want to say, before my question was, for Ash, he was like part of like my childhood. Like, I just want to say, like, you're amazing as Ash. Like, I feel like there's no other voice for that. I feel like my favorite was when you're Yukino and Keikano. So I just want to like, ask, like, what was your favorite part of playing Yukino and Keikano? Like, what was your favorite part?
Other
of
than you? Fainting, for that, what I loved about Yukino is that she is all of us. also. But in normal life, we can't go from happy to sad to angry to like hysterically laughing all in the span of 1 minute, which she really could. And all of what she was thinking came out.
Yeah.
And I really loved that about her. And yet she was a real character. It was really neat. And then we had all those episodes to kind of figure it all out, although everyone's upset that it ended too soon.
Yeah, like I was sad how like a budget, like, you know, the end, like, it, like literally like an episode of full paper, like,
yeah.
I could tell like some scenes, like especially the last episode, it was like, it wasn't, like, the production, like, wasn't well because, like, Japan, like, had, like, budget issues.
Yeah,
also,
budget.
Also, because I feel like there could have been season two, there could have been more.
I know, I wish there were, too. It was beautiful. I don't know if anyone's seen Caracano or His and Her Circumstances beautifully
done. Yeah, it's like, for you, or for me, it's like, your definitive role in me is keeping up from her.
Thank you.
So I think, you, like, for one, she's, like, a really, like, relatable character. It's like, I think you can, like, you really fit well in that role.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot. I did love it. Hello?
I would like to ask, what was the most awkward line you ever had to record?
There's been a few. There was one the other day. I mean, it's from a new episode that was compared to this in the studio, but way back when we did... what's the episode title? Too Many Birthdays?
Yeah, Many Birthdays.
So Many Birthdays. We changed that episode title like 5 times. So I never remember it. But it's the teenage Steven line, a boy on the cusp of manhood can't spend the whole day whackering. To this day, no clue how we got that on the air. I think standards of practice just fell asleep on that one, but hey! But over the kids.
Yeah. Not anymore. I don't know. Ash never said anything. Like, our standards and practices were really like,
yeah.
Gosh, anything that could be misconstrued was really, I don't have any awkward. I think all, once you get used to being in that universe, nothing's awkward anymore, you know? I mean, I was a 10-year-old boy on an adventure by himself with a guy who could cook and a girl who was mad about her bike being stolen. It's kind of like... everything else is fine. nothing really too weird.
I love how Brock's defining character trait is that he cooks.
Yeah, I know. Let's standards and practices.
Yep.
Something about the whole Brock
girl crazy professor Ivy. Let's just skip all of that.
We're done in our heads.
Right.
That was way overdone.
Yeah, it was.
How many nurse joys can you fall in
love with? That's right.
All of them.
Speaking of them. Yeah, all of them, of course. Thanks.
Hi.
Hi.
Okay, this is a question for Miss Taylor.
Yes.
Before she passed away, Maddie Blaustein had confirmed that Electric Soldier Paragon had been dubbed.
I don't know what that is.
It was the episode that got banned because of the seizures.
Oh, well, I don't know, actually. She may have known that and I didn't. I don't know. Unlike you, I didn't really even know what the titles were of the shows we were doing. And because we would just get this, we literally got, the, or actually, I overused literally. We actually walked in, got the script, walked into the booth, and started. No, it had the whole script, and it would have said the title at the top, but we spent no time saying what the title was. We did an episode or two a week, and we were just really cranking through in a way. So I don't know, actually.
Okay, I know there was another episode that never got aired outside Japan. It was called The Legend of Dratini.
Uh-huh.
That one got banned due to its depiction of firearms.
Well, and with other things like One Piece, they always
wrote a script.
So it would be interesting that they didn't.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm against kids watching shows with guns on Saturday morning myself, so I'm okay with something like that not being shown. But I don't know. I'm the worst person to ask about if these things are true.
Well, the other thing is, you know, there were still some other episodes of Pokemon which still had guns that still, you know, got passed. Like,
oh, yeah. Like,
here comes Squirrel Squad. You know, there's an episode where, you know, guns. All the villagers holding guns up to Ash.
Yeah, you're right.
I'm not looking to buy a new gun.
Yeah, I just blank all that stuff out.
Okay, so you wouldn't want to know because they have any information on, like, recording dialogue for those episodes? Could have, you know, fans have been wanting to know, you know, if those episodes were ever done, you know?
If they never aired, then we didn't do them.
Okay.
Because we didn't, they certainly weren't going to pay us to do stuff that they weren't going to do anything with.
There have been rumors that, you know, Electric Soldier Corps had gone for it to actually fix the whole seizure thing, but they had cold feet about airing it still, and it never got aired.
So. I don't think, I would say that if we didn't, if it wasn't going to be aired, they weren't going to dub it. So I certainly don't know, I don't think we did the episode with the seizures, unless they took all of that. The lights that took that made everyone have seizures.
They blurred it so that it was just, you know, instead of flashing,
yeah,
it was just
kind of. I don't know, because then unfortunately I didn't know that was the one. So anyway, I don't know.
Well, regarding the Dratini episode, I've heard that it actually was dubbed by 4Kids, but it was UCM's decision to not air it.
That's quite possible.
It was one where Ash catches all the Tauros.
Yeah, right, but that one that never showed, and then the next episode he just had the Tauros.
Yeah,
I don't remember recording the one catching a bunch of Tauros.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Wasn't that because it wasn't the fact that he was pointing the gun? I think it's that the gun's cocked or something, or the hammer strikes or something.
I don't know.
I remember reading an episode of a list of banned Pokemon episodes back
right.
then, and I think that was the state.
I should probably read that list too. You know, my thing is I just go to work, I record what they put in front of me, and I leave again and go to some other job. So that kind of thing, I didn't retain any of that because I couldn't afford to, in a sense. You know,
right.
You just kind of just get on to the next job.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know. I'll look into it and then see if I can figure it out.
I feel like I'm drowning sometimes in the Steven Universe fun facts, and I have to,
right.
I really have to, like, study it sometimes so I remember this stuff.
Yeah, I don't. Because also, when we started working on Pokemon, we didn't even know anyone was watching it. So who knew that I would be sitting here answering questions? We just went to work and left, thinking, well, I don't even know if anyone will watch the show.
Yeah.
So I didn't know I had to remember that. So we did have Pizza
Wait,
Fridays.
There's homework?
Yes.
I do thank you for being here. Happy New Year.
Thank you. Happy New Year.
For Veronica, if my sources are correct, I also did the protagonist for Ape Escape 2.
Jimmy?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm very fond of that game. Please tell me about your experience playing that character, including all the time you had recuperating your voice after a video game session and what you learned from playing as Jimmy.
Well, that, again, when you work on a video game, you only see your lines. And so I've never even seen the game, because whatever you play it on, I don't have. So so I've never even seen it. And that probably, I worked on the game probably 2 hours. All of this stuff is low budget, so everything gets crammed in to working very fast, which is why, you know, the question about when you want to be a voice actor or work on cartoons or video games, you have to get very good at reading quickly and figuring out what's happening in the scene and your imagination, especially because when you're reading lines for a video game, you don't have a lot of context. So I guess I found out later that he's a monkey, but I don't even know if I knew that when I was doing the game. It was a boy and it was a kind of a fun voice and all of that, but I don't really even know what he does in the game. Cause a lot of trouble, I hope.
No, he captures monkeys.
Captures monkeys.
That sounds like trouble.
That's close to, that's bad. Capturing your own kind.
No, they're going to take over the world otherwise.
I like that. I liked working on it, but I don't know that much about the game. I probably should come over to your house and play. And then... Yeah, thank you. Hi.
Hi. I have a request and a question for you. I think we all can agree that you're part of our childhoods when it comes to Pokemon and such. My request is, can you say Ash's signature catchphrase?
Would that be, I choose you, or, hey, Brocco?
my question is, would you say that there are a lot of things in Pokemon that can be made fun of?
Yeah.
Are you familiar?
Well, I mean, I make a lot of jokes sitting here right now, but one thing that I love about Pokemon is that It's a show that really began as a big commercial for the video games. And what it turned out to be, at least in the 8 years that I was lucky enough to work on it, was a show that had great heart, that had messages that we all took from it, that I learned a lot working on it, just about the power of friendship, the power of positivity, going for your goals, and how to go for your goal but not have to step on everyone else, like Gary, but how to be a better person. And so I think everything we can make fun of, and I think sometimes we make fun of even the things that hurt us the most, because that's our way of getting through it. And so not necessarily that Pokemon has hurt us the most, but you know, like you can always find a way to poke fun at something, but I don't necessarily, and I think that's a healthy thing, but I do think that there was a lot of good that at least I found with Pokemon.
Just as a note, are you familiar with the jelly-filled donuts joke?
No, actually I'm not.
Just to let you know, a lot of fans know about it. You should search it up on how many people make fun of it.
What, do you want to tell us now? Is it that bad? Can you not say it in public? Okay.
Basically, you know what onigiri are? Like those
rice balls, right?
Anyway, there was an episode, I think it was the Primeape episode.
Yeah.
Or whatever it was.
Yes.
And former Ash's hat got stolen.
Oh, I remember that episode, when his hat got stolen.
Yeah, anyway, there was...
It's like, it was Jimmy from Ape Escape.
There was onigiri, and for some reason, known only to the... Only like
the cool
kids,
people.
Doug changed it to jelly donuts.
Oh, right, they changed a lot of things.
Without actually changing...
Yeah, they changed a lot of food. Especially in the beginning, I think they didn't understand that we, as Americans, could... accept another culture's food. And so, you know, you have a rice ball that's a jelly donut and you have sushi that's a hamburger. I mean, it's,
yeah,
I know, but didn't we all learn to appreciate Japanese food? So, thank you, Pokemon.
I can attest that episode personally confused me as a child.
It's confusing. But then you have to reach out to your group of friends and discuss it at lunch.
We did.
Yes.
I have a question for you. My 9-year-old brother's going to be here tomorrow, but I don't know if he's going to make it to the panel, so I'm asking this for him.
Okay.
He wants to know what your favorite song in Steven Universe is.
I mean, as I said earlier, Stronger Than You, even though I didn't sing it, is just so...
I mean, that's everybody's favorite.
I know. It's
everybody loves that song.
I have so many favorite songs that I've sung, like Strong on the Railway, You Can't Go Wrong with Giant Woman, Cookie Cat, Steven and the Stevens was interesting because I had to layer the vocals 4 times.
Yeah.
But it was very fun to do like a Steven ensemble and Steven harmonies, and that one was unique, so it stands out. Cool cosplay, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Hello, hi.
So I have 2 questions for you guys.
Okay.
So for the concept of having to change your voice to play all these different characters, has your voice changed over time because of it?
My voice changed over time because puberty.
Since you mentioned, your voice is cracking.
Yeah.
That was
a struggle because I was working on 3 different regular shows when I had my voice changed, and Steven's the only one that I continued to work on because I couldn't play 8-year-olds anymore.
That's where I come in.
Yes.
We tag team on that.
Well.
Yeah.
But I managed to still do the Steven voice because it was such a character voice for me, and when my voice was high, I pitched down for Steven, so when my voice became low, I pitched up. And I mean, he sounds a little older, but I think that's... Yes, he has matured very much. The show's gone on, and with the new Steven model, we know that he is actually aging too. So,
I don't know that my voice has changed so much because of working on different voices, but I certainly understand the control I have over my voice more. I took a lot of voice classes. I went to college and grad school for acting, so I've had a lot of vocal training in that, so I warm up and I try to use my voice in a sensible way, even though I'm doing weird things with it. So that's helped me not to hurt myself so much.
And my last question was, coming into the performing acting world, was it your goal was, I'm going to voice act, like I'm going to dub things, or did you come in some other way and then discover that that's what you enjoy doing?
Yeah, I'm an actor. I started acting when I was 5. I love cartoons, but it certainly was never my goal to only work on cartoons. I do a million other things as well.
It was a complete accident for me. I came out to Los Angeles to be a film actor. I had a theater background in St. Louis, a little bit of film, but I knew that was what I wanted to do. And then one of the shows that I was working on for a long time, Adventures in Odyssey, it's a radio program, came around, and that sort of jump-started me and thrust me into that world. And it's been really good to me since, and I still do film acting, and it keeps me busy every now and then, and I'm trying to continue to pursue that. But the nice thing about voiceover, working regularly on Steven, is that it's one day a week for work, so I have the flexibility to do events like this and then work on film when I can, and it's very nice to have that.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hey.
What's your favorite part of working on Steven Universe?
I mean, there's a lot of favorite parts. We're very fortunate to have an amazingly talented crew behind our show, from our artists to our writers to the people who do the music. It feels like one big happy family now, and I feel fortunate that I have such a good relationship with the crew, and we can talk about the show, we can get along, we can hang out in the studio. And when we first started, it was like kind of nervous to go in the studio and meet people, and I felt like I was like auditioning for them still, and now I go into work and it's they're my friends, and I go in and I hang out with them, and we do voices and goof off, and that's my favorite part about doing the show, is that we have this bond, this unity now, and I hope that comes out in the characters too, because we have an awesome time in the studio goofing off.
Okay, cool.
That'll
get. That's okay.
Yes.
So, can you tell me about the experience of working on the Pokemon CDs?
The CDs?
Oh, yep.
You mean the Pokemon Christmas Bash?
Well, that, yeah, that's CD too.
Which one? That's the only one that I sang on.
Oh, sorry. How about the Pokemon Christmas Bash?
Yeah, we didn't sing on any of the other songs for the show, but we did do the Pokemon Christmas Bash, and that was hilarity. It was really fun. The songs are really fun. They're kind of campy. Everyone on the show, who worked on the show, wrote them. So I didn't write any of them, but it was really fun. Kooky, we listen to it at home once a year. did you like it? Did anyone ever hear it? Because I don't know how many it sold really, but it was pretty exciting.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi.
Hi.
Good morning. This question is for Zach. Who's your favorite fusion and why?
It's gotta be Sardonyx. Just because I love her color scheme and I love the broadcast host shtick that she has going on, and I mean the hammer too. Just everything about Sardonyx blew me away. They kind of set the standard for all future fusions to be judged by. But yeah, I hope we can like top it and do something even cooler in the future, but for the moment, Sardonyx is my favorite.
I've got a question for each of you. For Zach first, you mentioned earlier that your voice changed and that made it so you couldn't work on two other regular shows. Was there ever a time where, during the production of Steven Universe, when your voice changed, that they were considering someone else for the role?
Not that I know of. I probably would have known about that. I know that on Adventure Time, friend Jeremy Shada, I know his voice changed after the first or second season, and it was never really a concern for them. So I knew that Cartoon Network handled that a little differently than other networks. I didn't know if they were going to handle it differently for our show or not. It was certainly, honestly, I've never said this out loud before, but it was something I was worried about for a while. These other two shows, I was playing much younger characters on their shows, but I knew that I wouldn't be able to do it forever. And it was kind of up in the air for a while, and I really was trying to make as much of an effort as I could to keep the character voice of Steven alive, and I mean, I hope I did a good job with that, and I guess they keep me around, so.
Alright, and for Veronica, I want to know, because I know you said you didn't aim to be a voice actor. So I'll just ask in general, who were your inspirations?
For who did I admire as voice actors?
Well not just voice actors, just anything, like any actor.
My parents are great actors, and so they certainly have inspired me in the sense of, actually, I have four great parents, and they're my biggest inspiration, being able to follow and do what they love, and also be so incredibly supportive of me doing whatever I'm doing. I've always watched cartoons, so I loved, I got to meet Peter from Hernandez and Corinne Orr from Speed Racer, and that was a real kick for me, especially because I think of Ash as kind of like Spritel on Speed Racer, and Corinne Orr played Spritel, so that was very exciting to me. But you know, I'm a big Maggie Smith I love. I saw her in Canada at Shakespeare Festival one year. I love acting. I love actors who are really good. I don't know if anyone saw Sherlock last night, but you know, that's a great show. The acting is great. Everything about it is so good that when you watch great actors, you are transported. So that's kind of my aim, is to be able to inhabit characters, whether it be behind the microphone or on screen or on stage, and allow you, the audience, to be transported. So. Yeah, I just saw George Takei in Allegiance. If anyone gets to New York, go see his play. It's really great. He's fantastic in that. And it's his story, so.
All right. Thank you both.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
Okay, Veronica, I have a question for you.
All right, I'm ready.
So, you voice, it's kind of weird, but you voice both Ash and May in Pokemon.
Yes.
Wait, really?
Okay. Is that the weird part?
No.
Cool. Yes.
Okay, so there's many people who pair Ash and May together, as they do with every female that comes in.
Right.
So how does that make you feel, since you played both of the characters and they're kind of together in a way?
Yeah, and I played his mom too. It's a little bit weird, you know? Actually, it's really not so weird. It's not so weird. I'm so distracted by this thought of, I never really thought about them together. And you know that thing where you do this where you look like you're making out with someone?
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty much Ash and May right there. okay, that's a visual. That's what you get. That's the bonus for being here. Most embarrassing moment, that.
So, most embarrassing moment you're having a panel.
Well, I think I just had it. We record all the lines straight through, so Ash and May never had to pop back and forth, although I do a lot of audiobooks and also Ninja Turtles, we would do that prelay, and your show is prelay too, so if you're playing multiple characters, you still pop back and forth. It was a little bit easier with Pokemon, because you could easily do a whole scene with yourself, and I could listen to Ash while I was May. So the great thing about acting is that you can kind of really pop into a different character and not really remember that you were the other one. So it wasn't a conflict for me. I, like Zach, like doing scenes with myself, so it's really fun. And so I really enjoyed when I got to play all the characters.
I just think it's really funny.
They were never dating, though. I don't think Ash and May would ever date.
What about Ash and Misty? Because there's like, in the songs that they do, there's a lot of the thing with Misty like confessing her love.
Well, Misty is a wonderfully complicated girl who has many feelings, and Ash is not. He wants to go and be a Pokemon master, and I don't think he's interested in girls. And that's okay. He's 10.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Poor Brock.
I know.
Say, I've always been a water type aficionado, so
I
was always a Squirtle fanboy, and my favorite Pokemon is really random, it's Mantine, so, I mean, those two would definitely be on the squad.
You'd be a great Pokemon master.
Thanks, I've been training for years.
Yeah. It shows.
And my second question is, if Ash and Steven could team up, what would it be like?
Awesome!
And really loud!
Yeah!
It's funny, because whenever I'm doing like action scenes with Steven, sometimes I'll do a line read, and I'll be like, that was an Ash line that just came out of me. That I heard you do like years ago when I was a child, and it's like still in my brain, because I was so obsessed with Pokemon when I was a wee lad, but sometimes the line reads like the action-adventure style, because both of our shows
have
that energy to it. Sometimes it sneaks in there, and I find myself doing an impression of you, like subconsciously.
That's the great thing about working on a weird, positive, kooky show.
Yeah.
That luckily you have that weird, I mean for all of you too, you have those lines where that energy comes in, and that's kind of a gift because otherwise our lives would be so boring, you know? Or you think of things, I don't know. That is kind of neat.
Yeah. Yeah.
The characters are very similar in how gung-ho they are, so they would probably have a lot of fun on an adventure, but not get a lot done.
we'd need Pearl there in this day to, like,
in this day.
Crack the wind. Yeah. That would be it with us, but
right.
Pearl.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hello. This costume.
Congratulations. You've accomplished so much, you have such a legacy, and then you're building a legacy.
You're just beginning.
The new shining star.
The start of my own Pokemon adventure.
That's right. And yeah, we've started it here at SacAnime for the year 2016.
Happy 2016. Yes.
So anyways, my question is, since you have so many songs, when you're recording a song, how do you approach that when you need to record a song?
It's honestly the hardest part of Steven Universe for me is recording the songs, because singing in his voice is a challenge in itself, and also conveying emotion while singing is much more difficult than when speaking, for me at least. I don't know how the Broadway actors do it, but they really do help by writing amazing lyrics for these songs, and it's really fun, and it's a challenge to try and get the read and the take I want out of a song, and I get very like, oh, do it again, eventually like, Zach, it's perfect, we have like 7 takes of what we want, just let it go. There have been songs that I haven't been completely happy with in the past, and since like after I hear those, I'm like, okay, next time I really need to work on this, and this, and try and elevate my performance.
Alright, thank you very much.
Do you get the songs ahead of time, or do you get them that day when you show up?
I get them a couple days.
So that's good.
Yeah. Sometimes I take them to my vocal coach and work on them. It just depends on how much of a challenge I feel like that particular song will be. But I actually work with Rebecca Sugar on like finding keys that are good for my vocal range. And of course, my vocal range has been changing, so it's always a challenge to nail one down. But we've been pretty successful this far.
That's really neat. Yeah, a lot of shows you don't have much time to prep, and right. Then other shows you do. So in a way, I think that's a neat behind the scenes thing of you don't have very long to work on a song. So some of the songs that you guys love, Zach looked at a day ahead, maybe worked on a little bit, and then it all came together in the studio. So I think that makes it even more amazing. So
yeah, it's a very, I mean, like you said, sometimes they really push production very quickly on these shows to try and get them out. I mean, we have a lot of time between production and error as far as our part of the show goes, but even still, they really try to move things along and get things done in one session.
Hello. Can you do impressions of each other's characters?
I don't know if I can. Wait.
Hey, that's Steven!
Can I do yours real quick?
Hey, I'm Ash. I'm gonna be a Pokemon Master. I look really good.
That was a good one. I'm only slightly
good. No worries about getting your job with this. I think you've proven that now. My hopes are dashed. Yes.
Hello, I'm Joe. And it's nice to meet you both, my childhood hero and my present hero. And I just have a couple of questions. Veronica, this is for you. I know you have a successful life, and I just want to know, do you have any more plans for the future?
I have a lot of plans for the future.
And what are
And at the moment, my future holds projects that I'm working on, which is Mophi, which is a stop-action animated piece about a bunny.
Mm-hmm. I think I know that one.
Yes, thank you. I'm still working on Astro Blast, and we just started working on Welcome to the Wayne, which is a new show on Nickelodeon, and I'm still on Sailor Moon as Sailor Pluto.
Yes. And this is for Zach. I just want to know if there's, we can expect more songs in the future episodes.
Absolutely. Music is a big part of Steven, and it's definitely, I mean, we're always doing one. I don't know what the ratio of episodes that have a song in them would be, but they're pretty common, and not just for Steven, but for all the characters. And the musical numbers definitely tie the show together, so we try to include them as much as possible.
Nice. Thank you.
Thanks.
Since you were saying that it's really challenging for you to do the emotional parts of songs when you're recording them, I just want to applaud you on Full Disclosure from the opening of season two.
Thank you.
It's one of my favorite songs, and it's just heartbreaking. I love it.
Thank you. So that actually
applaud
means
you on that. Yeah, no, it's really wonderful. I love your voice. But I actually have a couple of questions for you, Veronica. I'm a really huge fan of Slayers.
Uh-huh.
And I was wondering what it's like finding a voice like Amelia that's like so high and dramatic and intense versus a voice like Ash.
Right, which is so not any of those things.
But she's much more like much higher register, and is it like different finding that kind of voice and how you found that voice? And then other follow-up question is it any different or is it weird working with Eric Stewart as Brock versus Eric Stewart as Gallery?
Well, first of all, we never are in the booth together for any projects we work on, unfortunately. In Ninja Turtles, we all got to work together, which was really nice. So it isn't, I love Eric Stewart. I think he's really talented, and so I don't care what projects we work on. I just hope we always work together. His characters are both really kooky in Slayers and Pokemon, similarly, but a bit more surfer dude in Slayers. So that's always great to work with him. I think there was someone else playing Amelia in the beginning, and they wanted the voice to sound similar to hers. I don't know that I ever heard whoever did it before, but they wanted
you
her to
better.
Be. What's that?
You sound better.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. It's she moved, and in those days you couldn't move and still be on a show, and anyway, luckily I got to play the part. But they just wanted her to be really high, and watching Slayers informs how intense she got and all of that. So that's a lucky thing when you're dubbing. You can really see what the character looks like. When you're not.
Very physical energy.
She's out there. And at one point we were doing Slayers, like I do Slayers in the evening and I was doing Pokemon during the day. And Amelia was a great character because she's so high that it really makes you feel happy. It gives you a little bit of a buzz to work on her. And it was nice because Ash is really boring in comparison.
So is it a lot easier to do the lower voice like Ash versus doing Amelia's voice?
You know, it all depends because on Astro Blast, I play a character who kind of is like in a here, and I can have a cold or I can be anywhere that day, and this is a little bit easier. If you're popping down in a here, it takes a little bit of a different strain. Way up here. You know, sometimes it might be hard to get here. Just because you're tired or maybe you have a cold or something. So working on taking vocal classes, you can learn how to pitch things so that even if you have a cold, you can get it out of here and pop it back into here and move it around. So nothing is too difficult, but certainly a lower voice is a little easier. Something down here is very easy.
Thank you.
You're welcome. That's how I answer the phone. Oh yeah, you can. Can you reach it? Yeah, I know we'll help you.
Who's your favorite Pokemon?
Pikachu is my favorite. Is that yours? Oh yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Hello.
Yes, I have a question for both of y'all. Who is Steven from Steven Universe? Am I right?
That's correct.
You voice Ash Ketchum from the first generation of Pokemon.
That's right. Season 1-8.
And here, I want you to do a line together. Could you say, hey, Steven, did you want to throw my balls around? And then make Steven says, ooh, I'm telling you. And then you just reply, say, no, Pokeballs. See,
okay.
They got Pokemon in there.
Wait, what do I say?
You say, ooh, I'm telling after when she says, did you want to throw my balls around? And
okay.
You just go, ooh, I'm telling. She says,
okay.
No, Pokeballs.
Are you a writer?
I'm thinking about making my own series.
Oh, okay. this is the start. hey, Steven, you want to throw my balls around?
Hey, I'm chilling, Pearl!
What do you mean? Pokeballs! I meant Pokeballs! Oh!
Oh, sure, let's do it!
Thank you very much.
I like your character from Slayers. She's very funny.
Thank you.
In Tom, Missouri.
Yes, and magical.
Mm-hmm. So, what would happen if Amelia accidentally ran into Steven who's in the universe?
Well, she wouldn't because she flies around.
Steven is unfortunately stuck on the ground.
That's right, so stuck. But she could actually help you out. She's got power of positivity. I think, you know, Amelia's very lovely, but she could get angry. She might get a little impatient with you, Steven.
That's what the bubbles are for.
Right, there you go.
Insurance.
She throws some very powerful punches. Yeah. I think that episode where she punched a guy for attacking her, it's because of a spell.
Right, right. I like that. I wish I were a little more magical myself. Thank you.
Don't we all?
Yes. Yes.
What episode was the Benny one?
What
episode was it?
Oh, I don't know where it was in the whole. We did that all as one piece, so I don't know how it cut up.
Okay, so I'll come back to it now.
She's screaming, and there's circles going around behind her, like,
okay.
It looks like that, that's all I know. It sounded better than that, though. Yes, hi.
This question's really quick.
Okay.
To everyone, hope your Pokemon ship is all right. Have you actually watched the XY series?
I have not.
Alright, there's a shipping that's called Amor Shipping between Ash and Serena, so I was wondering, what's your opinion towards it?
I don't have any opinion because I was replaced and I don't watch the show anymore. So I don't know about any of the new characters. Except, does Serena have dark hair? No, that's Dawn. I don't know. I don't know any of the new characters.
It's alright.
Sorry. But I don't think anyone should date within Pokemon. But that,
not even Brock and Nurse Joy?
No dating. No inter-character dating.
Or Officer Jenny.
Right.
Come on.
Yeah.
Those were all the Nashville's
lives. And then one for Zach.
Yes.
Without spoiling anything, since you're probably not allowed to do that.
Probably.
For our families.
Out of five upcoming Steven Bond episodes, which one are you the most excited about?
I'm actually not sure which episodes. Do you know the titles by chance?
The Answer, Steven's Birthday, It Could Have Been Great, Message Received, and Log Date, something, I can't remember.
Log Date is really good.
Is it going to mess me up?
No.
How messed up are you already? That's right, I mean.
No guarantees, but I mean, obviously it has something to do with Peridot, so
okay.
I obviously love it.
Strap in, it's going to be a big year. That's when you'll see.
Please, Rebecca, don't murder our feelings.
Oh, she already has.
Many times over.
Hi.
Well, thank you for what you guys do for all voice actors, you know, working in animation. I'm here as a father, and I can't tell you how much time and money I've invested with all of the animation, but especially to you, Veronica. Thank you for being Ash and Cole for being my boys. I basically raised them on Pokemon.
Oh, wow.
I joined from college last year.
Congratulations.
And we still have so much Pokemon merchandise.
Oh my gosh.
Even the cards and the Burger King.
Right, right.
Kids meals, boxes of this stuff. And you know, it's very endearing to us and our families. So just thank you.
You're welcome. If it helps, I didn't make any money off of that, so.
It doesn't help. You know, what it did is it
I had to buy that stuff
the
too.
Family and have a journey together just
yeah,
to do
I totally agree. And I think too, nowadays many families don't watch TV together. And Pokemon was a show that families watched together and also kids watched all at the same time. So you could go and talk about it in the playground afterwards.
Oh,
we just
yes.
don't have that now, and it's such a nice thing.
And I even have many favorite Pokemon and I used to do voices back when I was a little younger. Like I said, my boys graduated from college, so I think I lost my voice to do that.
You can still work it up for when they get home again. Thank you so much. That means a lot. Thank you.
Okay, you said rapid fire, so I'll make it
quick. Yes.
Okay, Zach, who's your favorite character besides Steven?
Like I said, it's a toss-up between a few of them, but the thing about Onion is that whenever he has to do his little I get to do that, so I'm kind of biased towards him. I guess I technically voice Onion, even though he doesn't talk. But yeah, I take pride in that. And Onion is just disturbingly weird.
Okay, Veronica, yes. A question for you. Who's your favorite character in Pokemon besides Ash?
Is there another character besides Ash? Pikachu.
Okay.
I could listen to the woman who plays Pikachu only and really, really enjoy the show. I think she does an amazing job.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Zach, who's your favorite homeworld gem?
Peridot, no doubt. P-Dot, P-Dizzle, Dorito, Shelby.
Hi. We're fans of Gravity Falls and we're surprised that it's come to an end that the creator is putting into his heart. See that happening in Steven Universe, we're worried that.
I see no chance of that happening anytime soon, willingly like that. I mean, Rebecca and the crew, I mean, they're super passionate about the show, and they've got, they're writing stuff that they want to happen in the show way, way, way in the future, like talking years if we can go that long. And they're really, really excited about it. Funny story, really quick, there was, we had an 8-week break, everybody on the show just had a break, and not just the actors, all the whole production. And Rebecca told me a story about her and Matt Burnett and Ben Levin, the writing team. They met in a park in secret. They weren't supposed to be working, but they had to write the show. They had to write more stuff for Steven, so they met in secret to discuss future plot lines.
Yes, our last question. No pressure.
Hi, Zach.
Hi.
So there's been a lot of emotional scenes on Steven Universe, and I was wondering if you've done any lines where you brought to tears by it?
Absolutely. I mean, whenever Steven is, his eyes are welling up, when you see that, whenever he's nearing tears, I mean, I've gotten close to him many times, gotten past that point many times on the show. I remember one in particular, I don't know if this take made the show or not, it's been a while since I've seen that episode, but the episode with the Little Butler Show, with the name I can't remember, when Steven finds out that his dad missed the fireworks show because they've basically been watching the show for hours on end, and he kind of loses it. That one was particularly emotional. That one stands out, but there's been a lot of episodes like that that have been kind of tough to do, but those are the ones that are ultimately rewarding as an actor.
Thank you.
Of course.
Thanks so much, everybody.
I did have one request, and if you guys are okay with it, I was gonna do the Cookie Cat rap.
Yeah! Aw, he's a frozen treat with an all-new taste, cause he came to this planet from outer space, a refugee of an interstellar war, but now he's at your local grocery store. Cookie Cat, he's a pet for your tummy. Cookie Cat, he's super duper yummy. Cookie Cat.